Hey, good morning. It's Thursday, August 8th. I'm Kill Casey, one of the information officers with Karen Scholl, our operations chief. And we are here actually at the Fairbanks Pipeline Training Center. And this is what we call our command post for the Chalkyitsik and Cornucopia complexes. And this is our break it down session where we bring you, the public, in to our inner world here and give you an idea of what we're doing out there in the Upper Yukon Flats, because there's a lot of fire in the landscape. And we have forward operating bases in Chalkyitsik, the village, and we used to have one in Venetie, and Karen can speak to how big that was in a while. There's a lot of crews and fire out there.
Yeah, there's still three crews out near Venetie across the river, and we've got a staging area there. We did also have a forward operating base in Beaver, and that has since gone away. We got rid of that yesterday as we wrapped up the fires in that area.
And so we want to bring you into what's going on this big complex that's now combined. So the Alaska team, which Karen and I are both a part of, has transitioned to the Alaska team. So if you've been following the Facebook videos with Clinton Northway for the past week or so, it's the Alaska team that handed off to the Alaska team. What that means for us is a lot of continuity in the planning process, and we want to show you how we do things. So the transfer command happened yesterday, that's 8-7, and these were all the planned projects for yesterday, and then we are able to track going forward each and every shift. We look out and we say what crews are going to come off, because it's not just that you can just call up an airplane and get everybody out of there, right?
Right. It is up here extremely difficult to move crews in and out of the villages and onto the fire. We have a lot of fixed wing as well as rotor wing helicopters that need to be involved in that. It's a big planning process. It takes a lot longer than typically you would see down in the lower 48 on their fires, where everything is roadside or generally roadside. So we need to know days in advance what's happening on each of our divisions, what they're planning to do that day, whether they're actually fighting fire, pulling hose, mopping up, gridding, moving from one place to another place. So all that takes a lot of time and energy to make that happen in a timely process. So we spend quite a bit of time back here at ICP in that planning process. And we project out every day. We sit down with all the key players, logistics, operations, all the team members back here, and we plan out basically 3 days in advance what we anticipate to be doing.
Right, exactly. So things like fresh food. We talked about in Alaska, the firefighters make their own food at their own camps out in the bush, and therefore on the planning process, we have to know what day that food's ordered, when it's gonna be at the ramp at Fort Wainwright, and which place it goes to, and make sure it all gets there, because those crews are putting in 14-day assignments, and every 3 to 4 days they're getting a fresh food box.
Right.
And that keeps them fueled up, because it's a lot of hard work. We've been showing you the YouTube channel for the transparency part of this, where you can see firefighters mopping up, you can see the drone shots of the area that they're working in. They're working along the Durangic River, they're working along, well, now that we have the bigger complex, they're working all the way around the geographic area. And so what we want to do is also make sure everybody knows the agency administrators for the land agencies in this region are going to sit with us as a team, and we're going to look at the weather, which has been raining a lot. We're looking at the workload, because the firefighters have been doing a great job, and so there's very few risks out there for the villages and the allotments. The work is more mop-up now.
Yeah, we have moved into the mop-up phase. We've been there for about a week now. We don't have very active fire on the landscape, so that should be pretty calming for folks out in the villages. Some of the villages and some of the areas have received quite a bit of rain, which has dampened down the fire activity. However, there are some areas out there that didn't receive a lot of rain. It's enough to kind of calm things down, but definitely not to put it out. So we still have folks out in the field monitoring that, working on the fires, and trying to ensure that the fires won't flare up and become a problem if we get a continued dry spell up in that area.
Right, and it can happen. You were mentioning 2010 earlier when we were talking about the dry falls in Alaska, where 2004 was a long fire season.
2010 also, those of you remember maybe the Pat Creek fire up north of Stevens Village. We were on that all the way through September, right into the beginning of October. Just we didn't get the waiting rains. This is Upper Yukon zone, Upper Yukon Flats, kind of known as a donut hole, so they don't get as much precipitation as other places will be getting. So here in Fairbanks, we're getting a large amount of rain up there. It's not getting there yet. So could be a dry fall. We're not quite sure yet, but we'll leave things in place if we need to. Mm-hmm. Certain areas on the fire, that would be pumps and hose, so that if we needed to re-engage on the fire, it would not take a huge effort. We would just be able to insert people quickly and be able to manage what's going on out there.